Namaste, I'm Shashi Gosai and welcome to the YouTube channel Simple Hinduism, which is dedicated to simplify the Hindu religion, culture, fasts and feasts. So we continue our journey through the Bhagavad Gita and we're on to chapter 8. Now we saw in chapter 7, Shri Krishnaji giving a detailed description of Ishvara and stressed the importance of recognizing the immense aspect. This chapter is perhaps one of the more philosophical ones. It deals with life after death. And it starts off with a few questions. And the first question Arjun asks Krishnaji is, what is Brahman? Shri Krishnaji answers that Brahman is a supreme eternal essence, which is indestructible. Number two, what is Adhiyatma? Shri Krishnaji replied that Adhiyatma is the self, which is a unique combination of sattva, rajas and tamas. Number three, what is karma? Shri Krishna replied that it's the force that causes existence. It brings matter into an object form. Number four, what is Adhibhootam? Shri Krishnaji replied that this is all the perishable, the visible matter around you. Number five, what is Adhidaiva? And Shri Krishnaji replied that this is the intelligence or the spirit that resides within every person. Number six, what is Adhiyagn? And Shri Krishnaji replied that that's a Lord within us, the witness of all activities and relationships that we have. And the total aspect is Brahman, the ultimate formless entity. In the last chapter, Shri Krishnaji had mentioned that one who remembers Ishvara at the time of death will attain Ishvara. So the seventh question Arjunji asks Krishnaji is, how does one attain Ishvara at the time of death? In most cases, we won't know when we're going to die. We could die suddenly in an accident, or we could have lost our mental faculties and don't remember anything. So Krishnaji says that although we cannot control the thoughts and the time of our death, but it's the outcome of a lifelong thinking that will actually impact our final destination. Us humans are always preoccupied with thoughts. Now, the thoughts could be regarding your work, your family, your relationships, your health, or even spirituality. And Shri Krishnaji gives the ultimate teaching. Since the thought at the time of death determines our fate after death, and the thought of death is an outcome of a lifelong thinking, Shri Krishnaji instructs us to remember Ishvara at all times, no matter what duties we are performing at the time. This is similar to the mind of a mother, that no matter what she is doing, wherever she is, the thought of her children will always be at the back of her mind. And this is something similar we should do for Ishvara as well. We're not asked to just give up all our duties, retire to the forest and just meditate on Ishvara. Krishnaji says, just remember Ishvara before we perform any duties according to our Swadharma. Now we do have these thoughts all the time, but if we can understand that everything that we see, do, hear and even know is Ishvara, that is halfway to getting into our spirituality. So just by constantly remembering Ishvara in our normal day-to-day duties, we can change our final thoughts to Ishvara. This constant meditation upon Ishvara is called Upasana. And first, Shri Krishnaji actually describes the technique of meditation. So let's have a look at that first. Most of us will find it very difficult to meditate upon something that we can't see or hear. We need something with a name and form. Then Shri Krishnaji says that we can meditate upon any deity, but we just have to remember that it actually points to Ishvara and the supreme divine person, the whole eternal essence that's around us. Krishnaji then describes the grandeur of Ishvara, the force that holds the whole universe together. And this is how he describes him. The all-knowing and timeless, the one who controls everything, the one who maintains everything and distributes the result of actions. The smallest particle, not visible even to the most powerful microscope. The ruler of all. The incomprehensible. The radiance behind the sun. the light that drives away darkness and ignorance. So we should try and remember Ishvara in any of these forms throughout our lives so that it becomes a final thought at the time of death. When we rid ourselves of selfish desires, likes, dislikes, hate, joy, sorrow, we kill our ego. And that automatically increases our devotion to Ishvara. And as our devotion increases, our thoughts, which are jumping from one topic to the other, quieten down, and we get this kind of absolute calmness. And this is what actually increases our devotion on a daily basis, when we actually see the effect all this is actually having on our mind. So if we develop this daily habit of meditating upon His name, it'll become naturally there when it's time for us to leave this world. And as He says, the one who thinks about this with devotion at that time will certainly attain the Supreme Divine Spirit. Shri Krishnaji then describes a person who can meditate upon His name to attain the supreme goal. And he is one who has managed the control of his senses and mind, can concentrate on God, and has a strong desire to inquire into the knowledge of the eternal essence. Intense meditation requires tremendous effort and practice. And there are four steps. Controlling the organs of sense perception, reducing the number of thoughts, directing the life force to the focus on the forehead, continuing to remain in this state of concentration for an extended period of time. Krishnaji says the one who can perform meditation on the syllable Om or utters Om in his last breath will certainly attain Ishvara. The sound Om denotes Supreme, the Brahma, the eternal essence. Om helps the person to cut his connection to his finite ego and take him towards the infinite eternal essence. Shri Krishnaji describes a present condition. It's very transient and there's no permanence. Even our body is changing in every single second. And similarly, he says that all the aspects of our life are temporary and will be changing. He calls our body abode of sorrows. One only starts their spiritual journey to attain Ishvara when one realizes the misery of the cycle of birth and death. Only those who sincerely pursue this path attain the supreme goal, the Ishvara. According to the scriptures, we have heavens. And all beings on this earth who have performed good deeds with devotion will go to one of these heavens after death. Only those who attain Ishvara at the time of death get liberated, or is called karma mukti. Shri Krishnaji then talks about cosmic creation and dissolution. The period of creation is known as Chaturyuga, which is the four realms of time. The cycle of creation of mankind is said to begin with Satya Yuga, which is the age of truth, followed by Tetra Yuga, during which time three avatars of Vishnu were there. Fourthly, Dwapara Yuga, a period of compassion, followed by Kali Yuga, or the age of discord, which is our current yuga. Shri Krishnaji says that when the day of Lord Brahma begins, the entire universe made of living and non-living elements wake up and begin to act. This spans 4.32 million years, which is equivalent to one day of Lord Brahma. So Shri Krishnaji says that when the day of Lord Brahma begins, all the elements in the universe, living and non-living entities, wake up and begin to act. And this carries on throughout the day till the end of the day, when they all go back to sleep in its unmanifest form and start again the following day. The analogy here is like in a movie film, the entire movie lies in its unmanifest form in the reel. When the reel is loaded and the projector light is turned on, all the characters come alive. When the reel ends, all the movie characters are dissolved from the screen, and then the process is repeated for the next show. Hence, the universe is never destroyed. It just goes into a state of suspended animation and gets unfrozen on the next day. This is consistent with the law of energy and matter. Neither energy or matter is created or destroyed. They just transform from one state to another. It's a scientific fact. Once we understand that every action that we perform will yield a result sooner or later, we will realize that this universe works on a set of principles. It has its own laws. Nothing is random, and everything will have an effect, but you will just have to see that there was an earlier cause for it. So it's amazing, cause and effect. Cause could have happened, you know, many generations, many centuries ago, but at some stage you will have to pay for it. And this is a fundamental teaching. So we will understand that when we perform actions in the spirit of Karma Yoga, the actual performance of actions are in our hands, but the results are according to the inbuilt laws of the universe. As we saw earlier, nothing is created or destroyed. The number of beings remains the same in this universe. So some die and some are born again. But the name, form, or even species could change. But the total number of what we can stuff in the universe has remained constant. Shri Krishnaji says that all beings, whether it's birds, animals, plants, or humans, are stuck in this wheel of birth, death, rebirth, called the wheel of samsara. And the only way to get out of it is through this spiritual path. Shri Krishnaji informs us that there is something that is beyond the cycle of creation and dissolution, something that transcends time and space. In other words, everything is transitory and will lead to sorrow. So unless we realize that everything that we think is giving us temporary now will be destroyed tomorrow, we will never become aware that there is happiness beyond this materialistic world. So after Shri Krishnaji has described this cycle of birth, rebirth, which is just, you know, a cycle of sorrows, he explains to us the need to get this liberation. And this liberation is only through the pursuit of Ishvara. So the seeker who performs Karma Yoga with this devotion to Ishvara will get Ishvara when his time on this earth is over, never to be reborn on this mortal world again. Ishvara is the cause of all creation. But it's not that he just stands back and sees what's happening. He's like the ocean that's created waves. So the waves are still part of the ocean. We're still part of Ishvara. Ishvara is everywhere, beyond space and beyond time. Shri Krishna then goes on to talk about Jiva after death. The journey differs from person to person and is determined by how we have acted and how we have thought. In other words, our actions and thoughts in this cycle decide what happens in our next life. The Lord says there are two types of people and two heavens after death. The first one is Chandralok. Chandralok, the lower heaven for those who perform good actions in their lives. They enjoy the fruits of their earthly actions and are reborn. And secondly, Brahmalok, the higher heaven for those who perform good actions, are devoted to Ishvara. They reside here until dissolution, after which they're liberated or they attain Brahman. Shri Krishnaji concludes the 8th chapter by telling us that he's given us a flow chart for the afterlife. With this knowledge, we have the means to achieve heaven, rebirth, or liberation. And the outcome slowly depends upon our behavior while we're alive. Traditionally, seekers use instructions in the Vedas to perform rituals, austerities, or charity with the aim of attaining a better state in the afterlife. In our case, we may not do the same rituals, but our eventual goal is the same. We try to do good deeds and charity in order to earn merit for afterlife. However, we will exhaust these merits and will have to return, be reborn onto this earth. Therefore, Shri Krishnaji recommends the bright path of devotion and action that leads us to the abode of Lord Brahma and eventually into liberation. This is called Karma Mukti. So to summarize, Shri Krishnaji tells Arjun that the secret of life is the path of yoga. It frees us from evil, pain, and the material world. Our karma sends us back to earth again and again in the form of prakriti or the material form, born again and again to life until our karmic cycle is extinguished. He has created the laws of nature on earth, the material world, to essentially reset the collective karma. He says the foolish do not see the divine behind all that is nature or prakriti, but the learned souls see it as an illusion masking the truth of the world. Those who simply follow the Vedas, offer rituals and sacrifice or worship at the altar, may free themselves from sin and attain heaven temporarily, but still they're chained by desire and must return to. Only the wise who worship and meditate on God constantly without any other thought attain the supreme state and are given liberation. Well, I hope you enjoy listening to a little bit of Bhagavad Gita. Please do log on to my YouTube channel, Simple Hinduism, to see the rest of the chapters. Meanwhile, this is Shashi Gosai in London. See you soon. Thank you.